So welcome to Off the Wall, Examining Digital in Gallery Interpretation. I'm Margaret Sternbergh. I'm a gallery interpretation specialist, and I'd like to introduce the rest of our panel, if we want to just go down the line.
I am Adrienne Lolly Hills, apparently an unauthorized member of this panel since I wasn't on the program. So I'm from the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art in Kansas City and a senior interpretive planner.
I'm Taylor Peterson from the Field Museum in Chicago and a digital project manager for the exhibitions department.
I'm Chelsea Shannon. I am the gallery interpretation specialist at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston.
Hi, I'm Tina Shah. I'm a senior developer in the Digital Experience Department at the Art Institute of Chicago.
Awesome, and everyone's really loud. Yay! Okay, so before we dig into our discussion today, we wanted to expand on the subtitle of our exhibition, or our subtitle of our presentation, and that is Examining Digital in Gallery Interpretation. And it's a term that we've been kind of throwing around as a group, and we wanted to define it a little bit today so that we're all on the same page. So these are the three basic things that we were looking at and we're gonna only focus on today. So that is a product with a digital format, something that's installed in a gallery or gallery-like setting, and it must be near or with an object. So we're not gonna talk about mobile today, we're not gonna talk about audio tours, so if you wanna get up and leave, that's fine. And the reason why we really wanted to focus our discussion today is because one of the things we've been kicking around as professionals in the interpretive field is that there's a lot of different ways to present media and content today, whether it's an interactive experience, adding conservation elements, text, images, videos, GIFs, or GIFs, depending on how you pronounce them. But one thing we noticed is you're still experiencing them much the same way you experience a traditional wall label. But usually they're off the wall, hence our presentation title. So we really wanted to use this as a moment to think critically as a field. It's a time where the technology and visitor expectations are really finally at the same place, and we can do so much as an industry. So it's time for us to really start thinking critically and get on the same page and think about what we call these products. Are they kiosks? Are they stations? Are they interactives? Should we call them products? Should we call them tools? And we really want to get everyone on the same page and look to the future. So that's probably way too much to do in 60 minutes, but we're gonna try. And we also know that what we're doing here is only a small sliver of what's happening in our field as a whole. So we're gonna spend 5 minutes each talking about a case study, and then we're gonna really hope to have at least 30 minutes for a luxurious discussion amongst ourselves and you all about some key questions. But I really, really would love for all of you and your colleagues to contribute to this discussion. So we put together a database, spoiler alert, it's just a Google form, that we want you to contribute to. And it's gonna help us start building a common language, some metrics, ways of thinking about digital and gallery interpretation. There's a link on the screen, bit.ly digiinterp. There's about 10 questions. It's all nuts and bolts, like, how did you install it? Did you do it yourself? Can we contact you with additional questions? And we'll send this out probably in like 2 or 3 weeks when we get kind of critical mass of people contributing to it. I'm also gonna send this out in the listserv, so please join us in adding to the field. And without further ado, we're gonna start with our case studies. Adrienne, do you wanna jump in?
My favorite title for this type of interpretive element, I asked a security guard once what he would call it, and he thought for a really long time, and he said, digital screen. And I was like, that is at once accurate, but incredibly vague. I love it, so. All right. I also sustained a karaoke injury last night, so I hope I get through this. All right, so my name again is Adrienne Lolly Hills. I'm from the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art in Kansas City, Missouri. And I'm gonna be talking to you about a project called Gallery Plus, but following this talk, we're going to actually be debranding it. So I would love your ideas for names. All right, so the Black Galleries opened in March 2017. It was a complete reinstallation all the way down to the studs of refabbing several galleries and incorporating 29 new masterworks from a large gift. That was supported by an $11 million monetary gift that supported the reinstallation of the space, as well as deep integration of digital technologies, whether lighting, interpretive, or administrative. It was really a turning point in the way that we integrate interpretation into permanent collection spaces. So a lot of my team's focus was actually on analog elements like text panels and actually hewing to best practices and label copy. We also really worked closely with our curatorial staff to think about thematic groupings of objects as opposed to the Death March of Art History, which was the more taxonomic approach. So that was really exciting, but I'm not going to talk about this here because we're talking about tech. Digital interpretation was also a priority. We integrated detour platforms, so using location-aware technologies and immersive walks, which we'll be talking about later, as well as several standalone kiosks that I won't be talking about today that focused on art making and close looking. Something that was nice was that the big idea that our interpretive and curatorial team had established really emphasized providing visitors with context for these works, as opposed to looking at single objects and analyzing them in absentia of culture. So that was really exciting and something that really stuck with us and was super salient to Gallery Plus. It was probably the interpretive element that emphasized our big idea most explicitly. It was installed on 4 iPads tethered to 3 different benches, and the concept that I had provided our developers and our content team was I wanted it to be like reading Teen Vogue in the dentist's office. It can be as deep as you want it to be, but you can also scroll through it and get a really 40,000 foot view of the period of Impressionism and Post-Impressionism. So really, it provides a contextual overview of the period, and I would think of it as more of a text panel or a section panel than a digital label, because I'm not really interested in a single object. We're talking about it as an aggregate. Okay, so our opening page has... What?
You must have animations on it.
Yep, it's up. Our opening page was kind of like the front page of your magazine. It randomized each day for our repeat visitors who may want to see something new and different, and those would take you to a specific page. We also had a more traditional organization up top. We provided an overview of objects on view in the gallery, which was basically just cribbing extended labels. I wasn't super excited about that, and we'll see how the evaluation pans out. We also provided a timeline of events, and those were organized by cultural, the arts, history, and other things. I'm already over time, almost over time. And then we also provided synthesized, playful content in the form of quizzes and games, and something I was really excited about called Matchmaker, where we match an artist or a work of art with something random. So we had Joni Mitchell and Van Gogh, we had Pizarro and Sherlock Holmes, and now we're working on modernism content and getting a little crazier and connecting Seinfeld with Brancusi and just providing really playful ways to think about the interaction of arts and culture. So this was a design sprint that we did over 6 months, and that included building the thing, writing the content. We worked with a web developer who unfortunately was pretty unfamiliar with museums. In our case, that was kind of a detriment, not a good thing. Concept and content was led by us, and curatorial did provided research support and fact checking, but we found that we were a little bit better positioned to write this in the tone that we wanted. And we also did front-end evaluation of visitor interest in specific modules. We're presently doing a large summative evaluation of the entire reinstallation. We're using focused interviews, personal meaning mapping, and then a specific interview looking at Gallery Plus. Something that really sucks about this is that our analytics never really worked, which ended up being, I know I'm hearing all these people going, meh. Honestly, it was kind of a blessing in disguise because it helps us focus really on what people are getting out in a more qualitative sense from this element. We're going to be moving forward with another platform we're migrating over to Culture Connect, and we'll have much more reliable analytics, more editorial control. So it was kind of one of those things that sucked at the time, but we're kind of finding some advantages. So our next steps are we have leveraged that it exists. I can't even say it's a success yet, but we've leveraged it to get some grants that will allow us to invest in permanent collection digital interpretation, which is pretty exciting. I'm moving over to a new role called Manager of Digital Learning that was created to support that. And what else are we doing? We're also thinking about what this would look like if we were to put it on the web. We don't really have a unifying digital strategy quite yet, but once we do, we'll think about adapting some of this content or not at all putting it online. So that's a question yet to be answered. And that's it.
Thank you, Adrian. How are we doing audio-wise? Can people hear us in the back? No. Okay, so we should talk louder. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay,
so we really gotta
get closer.
Lean in, Taylor. You got it. Oh, there are a lot of seats in the front if you'd like to move forward. We're all friends here. We're friendly.
All right. Is this okay?
Yeah.
All right. I sang Bowie last night, so my voice is a little crackly. Sorry, I have to stop and cough. All right, so Cyrus Tang Hall of China at the Field Museum. I have a lot to toggle here. Okay, so we opened this exhibition in June of...
Clicker, yeah.
Okay. We opened this exhibition in June of 2015. It features 5,000 years of Chinese history and culture and covers 6,000 square feet. It features over 350 objects from our own collection, and has also some really beautiful multimedia elements in there, such as these landscape projections you see here, shadow puppet theater. We have new dioramas, interactive Qingming scroll kiosk as well. And with this exhibition, the Field Museum is now the only major U.S. institution to feature an anthropologically focused exhibition of Chinese history and culture, so that's pretty exciting. As you can see, the design is very immersive and transportive, but in a very elegant way. We wanted the space to be very contemplative as well, and you can see how that influenced our technology design. Okay, so the Field Museum has a long history of digital engagement within our gallery spaces, where we often develop kiosks and games and things like that in tandem with our displays and objects. But this was our first foray into almost 100% digital content delivery. So it was a big risk that we took. And why did we do this? There was, a large technology gift floating around in the background at the time we were working on this project. And we really wanted to capitalize on that because this is an anthropology exhibition. It's really important to tell multiple perspectives and stories about each object. So we really thought we could use technology to leverage that and just provide visitors with more information. So at their core, the interactive labels, which you can see, they kind of look like they're floating below the cases. The strip above is print ID text that's backlit, and then those big panels on the side are backlit graphics as well. So the meat of the content is digital in those rails that are located below the cases. So they act very much like a static print label would, the same goals, but the main difference is that they provide visitors with the ability to choose what they want to read and dive into. We realized that was an important thing to build out from some front-end testing we did. We did two different approaches to that. One was an audience segmentation, larger project that we did where we tried to understand what our different audience segments wanted from technology and how they interacted with that in our galleries. And then the other set of front-end studies were just some very digital label specific things where we were able to tune in on what some features of attractive labels would be, and the power of choice really emerged from that. What also emerged from that was that we didn't and we shouldn't overwhelm visitors with technology. So we really were inspired by the look and feel of a print label and just kind of ran with that. So like, if it was print, this is how it would be formatted. Now it's digital, so how do we make that work? So you can see how that print aesthetic really informed the integration strategy throughout the hall. They're nicely tied to each case. The display format, it's a really wide horizontal panel looking thing. And then if you read the content, you can also kind of get the sense that the tone and organization follows what a print label would do as well. I don't know, was that, I don't think that video is playing. Thanks, Margaret. So the, as I mentioned, we have over 350 objects on display. There are 45 of these labels total, so they're located at most cases. We custom developed the hardware alongside an outside partner. These are no longer in existence. We can't get a lot of the materials anymore, so this is all we have. So from a maintenance perspective, that's kind of crazy. But they're measured 35 inches on the diagonal, so it was very much like a print label size. We also did software development in-house as well, so it was a completely homegrown endeavor.
So this is supposed to be a video, it's not playing, sorry.
Yeah, just try to give you a sense of how people interact with them in the gallery space. All right, so I can just do a quick walkthrough of what this interface looks like. The design and information architecture is consistent on each of the interactive labels to ensure that the learning curve stabilizes as visitors encounter more. As I mentioned, there are 45 of them. So this first screen is on the text on the very far left is static theme text, and that kind of addresses the case as a whole. And then you have your object selection menu where you can choose to dive into what you want to read about. And these are pictures of the exact objects that are in the case above. When you select one of those, you get a story selection menu. And then when you choose that, you get the expanded media view, which offers you a zoomable image, a slideshow, video, 360-degree object photography, and custom maps, and all sorts of fun things. In total, there's over 1,100 of these assets that live in the labels. A lot of them were made in-house or we outsourced, so it's a lot of asset management as well. All right, so here's a quick snapshot of our design process. The team that worked on these was culled from the larger exhibition design team, so we didn't have a lot of labor working on them. You can also see we were working against a very tight timeline. A lot of our time was spent just iterating the design because we needed to come up with, as I mentioned, this consistent template. And before we got that right, we had to get that right before we developed the meat of the content. So you can see we spent a lot of time on that iteration, which we started with paper, moved to digital, and then kept going from there. One thing that was a really cool opportunity was 9 months before we opened China Hall, we redesigned the bases in Stanley Field Hall around our elephants and totem pole displays. And the content that had been around there was from like the 90s or something. So we were able to redo all of that. And we devised this early concept highlight. We're calling it a highlight rail, which is just more thematic information. So that allowed us to play a little bit on the early end with software and just kind of throw some ideas out there. All right. So just to take a snapshot look at what we're doing now, we do have analytics running on the back end that allows us to see what people are doing and what they're not doing. They're not going very deep. We did partner with Northwestern University on a NSF grant that we were hoping would give us more user journey information than it did. That study ended up taking more of a pedagogical approach, but we were able to play around with some design work that allowed us to pull out some of those cool object stories to the surface, and we found that really pulled the engagement rates got a lot higher from those. So that's something we'd like to explore going forward. Since we've done the China Hall exhibition, we've done a lot more of what I call those highlights rails. Again, we've been redesigning, pulling content to the top. We've been optimizing our software. We're not doing hard. We're not working in older technologies anymore. We've moved everything over to web, which has been really helpful. We've also, since right after we opened, we dove into a companion website project that has 100% of the content online in English and Chinese. And because we were so templatized with the exhibition, it allowed the web build to be very scaffolded and systematic. Now this clicker isn't working. Can you advance it for that?
Yes. Hold on.
All right, so what's next for us? We are thankfully finally heading into our own summative study this spring, so we can kind of pick up where the study that we were doing left off and really get a sense of what the user journey looks like, how they're interacting in the hall. We want to know, when they walk up to a case, are they looking at objects? Are they getting the content that they want on the screens? How can we, you know, what's the full picture of what that experience looks like? Which leads to a lot of design questions, of course. If we were to do another hall-wide system, I think, you know, just making sure it's all responsive web so we can have other outputs in the future, and thinking more cohesively about a back-end network system and CMS where we can just broaden the project instead of it living with the few people who worked on it and make sure it ensures and lives. It is a permanent hall, so it's very important that this is sustainable in that aspect as well.
Okay. Thank you, Taylor.
All right, hello. So I am from the Museum of Fine Arts Houston. I am the gallery interpretation specialist there, and I am going to take you through a couple of DIY kiosks that we have installed in both our permanent and special exhibitions. And as a way to kind of frame these projects, I want to show you one of our galleries. This is one of our permanent collection European paintings galleries. It is a pretty traditional gallery space with pretty traditional interpretation. There are wall labels, there are some stray text panels you will encounter. We do have an audio tour, though we're kind of thinking about revamping that, but again, the kind of visitor experience is pretty traditional. So we have been doing some in-house experimentation in providing content through digital platforms. And when I say in-house, I mean it is actually all created, the design and content in the learning and interpretation department. We do not have anyone doing any coding or programming or anything like that. We actually use this program here called Flovella to do this. I'm gonna say I don't have any financial stake in this program. I'm not pushing it on anyone. I just think it's a really great way to try some things out. It functions very much like PowerPoint. It allows you to put together a presentation. It does have touchscreen capabilities. So when you load that presentation onto an iPad, it functions very much like an app. So I'll show you a couple of examples that we have created using this platform. So the first, and really kind of one of the first digital experiences we've had in our museum was in this permanent collection space installed like a cabinet of curiosity. So prior to my joining the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, we had a CRESS interpretive fellow who did some really good research and work in this space about how to provide information about the objects that are on view, because as you will notice, there are not labels installed with these works. So visitors would walk in and not really know what they were looking at. So the first kind of iteration of interpretation in this space, you can see it on the far left, were binders. They were analog, you could flip through and get tombstone and some chat information about the objects. This was then translated into a digital experience using the Flovella platform to, again, just provide a way to give label information and chat. It is a layout of the gallery. You can click into any of the objects that are on display and land on a page that looks like this. Again, typical label information. We did have kind of some additional space, and so some additional opportunities to provide some more kind of interpretive content, which we place in these kind of gray boxes to the right, making connections, visual or thematic, between objects in the space. So a little bit more than just your typical label. So that experience is currently in our permanent collection gallery, and we have been using our special exhibitions as a way to pilot other kinds of experiences. So this was an exhibition, a small exhibition of works on paper called Vignettes. And in speaking with our curator about what some of our interpretive goals for this exhibition were, we decided we really wanted to focus in on this engraving that you see on the left of Louis XIV. It's a masterwork of engraving technique, so we wanted to give people a little bit of a window into how this thing was made and the intense skill required to make it. So we created a digital experience that provided a couple of different windows into that process. It was a little bit of a choose your own adventure. Visitors could choose to explore the engraving technique through a kind of a selection of multimedia. These are both images and videos. If you click into them, some of them are autoplay videos, as well as some great microscopic imagery that we had of this piece from our conservators that allowed visitors to see up close the kind of density of line and pattern in this piece. So we are very much kind of in our nascent stages of thinking about digital interpretation in our gallery. So we are experimenting very much with these platforms. We're also experimenting with our evaluation, trying to determine what kinds of feedback, what kinds of information is going to really help us to strengthen these experiences. Our department is actually engaged in a long-term research study with the firm Slover Lynette to look at our audience, look at what they are seeking in a gallery or museum experience in general. We are looking at specifically the word engagement. You know, we in museums throw that word around a lot, and we're trying to drill down and think about what our visitors are actually looking for in an engaging experience. So this is all very preliminary findings right now, but we're trying to frame our evaluation of our digital experiences in line with what we're finding from this audience study. There's a few kind of keywords here, the things or the qualities that our visitors find to be engaging or what they're looking for in an engaging experience. So things like hospitality, connection, relevance, nothing kind of outside of the realm of the ordinary, but it's nice to have some frameworks as we think about, can we measure whether our visitors are having engaging experiences with the content that we're providing? So we're not really measuring learning outcomes right now. We're really just trying to see if we can pinpoint the kinds of engagement or the quality of engagement that our visitors are having with these experiences. So I'm just going to end with kind of the what's next here. For us at the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, we are in the midst of a campus expansion project. So this is a view, a rendering of one of our new exhibition spaces in our new building of modern and contemporary art that will open in 2019. So we have an opportunity to kind of start from the ground up in this space and think about interpretation kind of across the board, including digital. And we are trying to take the lessons that we've learned from these experiments and apply them to a kind of master interpretive plan in this space.
Thank you, Chelsea.
Hello again. So, let's see here. Okay, so again, my name's Tina Shah. I'm at the Art Institute of Chicago. And before I talk about our current digital labels project, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention what came before in our galleries and what is still in use today. It's called Launchpad. We launched this project back in 2012. It's an application that runs on the latest iPad technology of that time in 2012. And I believe we have about 40 iPads spread across the galleries in the museum with many objects featured on one kiosk. The experience is much like a website interface, and visitors can choose an object and explore the object via animations, short videos, 360s, and interactive hotspots. In 2015, we did a qualitative study where we intercepted a range of visitors who use the Launchpad kiosks. We learned that instead of offering multiple ways to navigate the interface, visitors preferred a more guided experience and a simple interface. We also realized this simple interface could include just one story about one object, and that a short, simple story could go a long way. So in March of this year, we launched our digital labels project. We started off with 7 iPad Pros spread throughout our new Saints and Heroes galleries. Each iPad focuses on one object and is placed either in front of the object or as close as possible. This is a run-through of one of the experiences. As a visitor navigates page by page, the labels are short narratives that focus on one object. It's an image-centric, simple design. They give context to the object in front of them. And as I said before, the navigation is simple. The visitor swipes to move forward and backward, along with touch, pinch, and zoom gestures to dive deeper into the content, which is also increasingly commonplace behaviors. The transition that you see from page to page is especially important for us in our storytelling. The images move, rotate, and scale with you as you navigate, providing a seamless experience. The term digital labels isn't the most accurate to describe this project, but perhaps a better term will come out of this session. This project is a web application using the React.js JavaScript library developed by Facebook. It was developed over a 6-month period by an external contractor with a handoff at the end for continued development and support with our internal team. Here we go. So the unique aspect of this project is that we put in as much work into developing the back-end experience as the front-end. We were inspired by sites like Medium.com and Squarespace, where the form experience is no more. Here's a screenshot of the content entry experience. A colleague of ours mentioned multiple times that creating an experience in this environment is actually fun. Editing provides an instant preview of the end experience. Type right into the text area, and then you can upload a 360 object that can be reused from page to page. And then on each page, you manage what frame number and scale the object should show on each page. We then see the object transition from one set of frames and scales to the next. So again, this transition of that object and how it moves with you from page to page was essential in our storytelling. So first impressions, well, here are some comments from initial interviews with visitors. The digital labels are a great mediating technology. It helps visitors get more background information about the objects. The digital labels serve as an adjunct to the visual to concentrate the attention of what one may have overlooked. Another quote is, the screens add an extra sensory experience to this educative experience. Because it is closer to you than the object, and you cannot actually touch the object, but here you can touch the screen. And another quote is, the detailed representation of what's in front of you lets you touch it without really touching it. And then last one, it gives you a close-up look without being able to touch it. It allows for more observation of details and more fun than reading the label text. So measuring success. We are planning a formal evaluation now, but we hope that the digital labels, with the digital labels, visitors are learning more about the object than they would have without them. We do have analytics tied to different behaviors in the labels. We can see right now that the use of the labels has been consistent, busier on busier days, like over the weekends or when we have special events. We can see which are the more popular labels in the space. And this may have a lot to do with where they are located as well, even though there's one that's in the back of this gallery space that's getting a lot of attention, and we didn't think that people would get back there as often as we've seen. And we can also measure engagement by tracking events. For instance, how often visitors touch on the option to have a closer look at an object, like if you wanted to zoom in or play a video. And overall, we're hoping that visitors will share the experience with the company that they're with. Call a friend over to share that experience. So with the observations we have made so far, we've realized that there are already some changes that we can make to provide a better experience. We saw that visitors were not always able to close a modal window. So this is a window that opens up when you want to open, when you want to play a video. And we saw that that close button is kind of hard to get. You know, visitors aren't able to get to that right target at all times. So we saw visitors trying to touch that button once or twice. And so one of the first things that we changed was, you know, increasing the hit area of that button. So they don't always have to touch right onto the button, but just even close and it kind of lessens the frustration. We also saw that swiping up and down to advance the pages was not as intuitive as we initially thought. People were swiping left or right or tapping. So we added an animating swipe indicator button on subsequent screens to give visitors the idea to know what to do. We have a set number of templates right now to choose from to help tell the stories that we're thinking, but we're thinking about adding additional layouts. You know, what additional layouts we could create to help illustrate the story better. And we're also thinking about other uses and implementations of the digital labels. Could this be a tool to assist with tours or with docent training? And we are also thinking about how we can integrate this content on the web, what form it could take on the web. And last but not least, we are spreading the love. We're about to open source the code very soon, and we welcome collaboration. So, thank you.
Thanks, Tina. So I'm sure you all have burning questions for our panelists, but we have a great 20 minutes to discuss right now. So I'm so excited that we all stuck relatively close to our time limits. And we're gonna have kind of four key questions that we're gonna discuss as a panel, and then I'm gonna open it up to the audience for a couple of them. And then at the very end, we'll have time to answer questions about these specific projects and processes, if that's all right with you all. So to kick off our discussion, one of the things that keeps coming up in my practice as an educator is, what is the role of digital interpretation? And this idea, does it replace or does it augment a paper label experience? How does it affect the visitor's interaction with an object? Is it a distraction? Is it supporting them? And the idea that sometimes a digital experience can offer something for everyone. It can engage different learning styles, offer more points of relevancy and entry. So I'm curious, the panel wants to jump in. Maybe Adrian, you're very passionate about paper labels. So you might want to start off our discussion.
Paper is king. I feel strongly that all digital interpretation needs to live in tandem with good, solid, best practices analog interpretation, and that starts from the ground up. It's additive, but a amazing digital project is not going to salvage something that is fundamentally not visitor-centered.
Yeah. And Taylor, you guys are doing some, can we get some amens? Yeah. Does anyone have any strong feelings about paper wall labels versus digital wall labels, or what that dichotomy is?
Yeah. I worry a little bit about screens. Mm-hmm. I would think it would be interesting to see if you could measure people before and after in that space, how much they're talking with each other about the object.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Have or three, whatever the group, that because a lot of people bring some, somebody with them to a museum. If that just sort of quiets down and everybody just goes into their like phone or their iPad.
So I'm just going to repeat the question real quick because we're recording, but it's a great comment about how whether or not labels distract, and especially with the digital labels, and group dynamics. If you're doing something on your own on a screen, if you're losing that social interaction and the experience. And I think Taylor might have some things to respond to that, or Adrian,
oh,
if you're,
I
go
was
ahead,
jump in. I'm a Hermione Granger and can't stop talking. I think that that really underscores the importance of naturalistic observation with digital interpretation, just because if you're looking at visitor preference, like, oh yes, I love digital or I loathe digital, that really often doesn't align with actual behaviors once people are in the gallery. A lot of our assumptions are being undermined by actual good evaluation as to who uses it, what preferences they are. We're seeing a lot of groups use our bench-mounted iPads, and we have a good, we like that they're kind of free reign and people can share them between their laps. And if we find that people prefer to use them in a social context, then we're going to put them on larger screens. I want to see families interacting together, and that's definitely a intended outcome for our team.
Yeah, I completely agree. That's why I mentioned that study that we tried to do with NSF. We were hoping to really measure that social activity, like what are users really doing alone or in groups around these things, so we could think about how to expand them or change them, take them away. And just going back to paper, I mean, I would rather print something before build out a digital thing if it can live on a print panel. I think why do technology if it doesn't have something else to offer? So I think in a lot of these projects that we talk about, you know, they're offering new ways to interact and look at objects, and that's a perfect venue to leverage technology. I think also though, just in big picture, thinking really critically about the integration strategy, and so all of this doesn't, whether it's print or digital, doesn't enter in. It just really enhances the object itself. I don't think anything should really come in between that experience that visitors have. Like, we know from our audience, and probably a lot of you as well, that visitors come in and they want to escape and they want to see and they want to be immersed in these spaces. And so I think the design needs to follow suit and enhance that and enhance that relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'd also like to just kind of touch on that idea of social experience too, that we have found that our digital kiosks have been these really kind of like social moments in the gallery space. In observation, I think it's something like 80% of people in the Vignettes Prints exhibition were interacting with the screen with other members of their group. So it was more than just a, hey, come look at this. It was a standing around, looking, talking, interacting in the context of also learning about the art that they are viewing. So we have had great success with those digital experiences kind of fostering that human connection, which is something that we're really interested in right now at our museum, is how can we provide moments of human connection in our gallery? And so for us, the screens have been a way to do that, maybe above and beyond simple text.
Can I add to that? Yeah, go ahead, Tina.
And I agree with everyone, with everyone's comments about the social experience. And I, for example, our digital labels, there's a label that we have that talks about swords that are displayed in the gallery space, and there's actually videos in the labels that shows how those swords were made back in that time in the 17th, 18th century, which I think is great to expand that story about the object. You see these beautiful swords on display, but just giving more context to them is so important, I think, and hopefully does inspire more conversation around the object. And, what was I gonna say? Having what Margaret mentioned about having sort of multiple options for every type of every type of visitor and all types of moods too. I've been in situations where maybe I'm just, I'm kind of getting glossy-eyed and I can't read labels anymore and I want to, have a more interactive experience to sort of wake up. So I like that there are different options in the space.
Thank you. So our next question has to do with voice and the idea of, should it be the same or different from a wall label? Should it be the same or different than the rest of the content at your institution? what is the right amount of content with this voice? And I think that's something that we're all kind of dealing with, because this kind of product is also at the intersection of digital education and curatorial. So whose voice gets to kind of dominate in that space as well? And I think I love Adrian's example of Gallery Plus, soon to be rebranded, because it's a very specific voice. And I don't know if you want to talk about that at all, how you came to the Teen Vogue in the dentist waiting room.
Well, first of all, to the chagrin of our curators, we're using contractions. So,
ooh.
Whoa, watch out. But I've just been really inspired by, this is a little bit tangential, but in the past year, we've seen this renaissance of print media or of journalism in general. And I really enjoy reading, I cite Teen Vogue intentionally because under its new leadership and with writers like Lauren Duca, you see just really concise, amazing writing that synthesizes complex issues for a teen audience without condescending or pandering to them. So I've actually been reading a lot of Teen Vogue lately, thinking about how do we distill complex ideas and make them relevant to an audience that's not unlike Teen Vogue. So I'm looking at sources of inspiration outside of interpretive media, particularly because this format isn't a traditional wall label or audio guide.
So would anyone in the room like to share at their institution how they determined voice for a digital product, or if it varies at all from the rest of their institutional voice? Any best practices or experiences someone would like to share? What institution are you with? So at the New Orleans Museum of Art, the curators take their labels, share them with the education team, I'm assuming, and then they start, that's the basis for them to start tweaking and, in your words, dumb down, which is problematic. Okay. Okay, so again, another issue with the idea of space in digital spaces, traditional wall label content needs to be shortened generally, and that's it. That's something we run into. Yes, in the back.
And I
just want to summarize for the recording real quick. So Cooper Hewitt education and curators sit together in the same room, and where the content is delivered, the length is a little different. Is that right? Where the final content lives, the size of the text, the volume is different.
Yeah.
Okay. Chelsea?
Yeah, and I would just like to kind of jump in and say the idea of having kind of the educators and the curators in the same room and workshopping that language seems amazing.
It's the dream.
It's the dream, because I understand that. And at our museum, it seems to be maybe kind of similar to how the New Orleans Museum of Art works, where we are definitely doing a lot of back and forth between our interpretive team and our curatorial team. The content for our interpretives typically starts in learning and interpretation, and then, you know, again, with that back and forth, it is not totally efficient. But I would love to see kind of a more coming together of making the decision about what kind of language we're using coming from both places, I think would be important.
So adding outside voices, we could. It sounds like we could spend a whole session on this. I do want to just jump along to our next question, which is how and where we install the objects. And we kind of talked about that a little bit with whether or not we distract from the actual object. I think accessibility is vital in thinking about these elements. And then you also need to consider aesthetics. And I think, Taylor, you've got some things with accessibility that you're working on at the Field Museum.
Yeah, sure. So in the case of the Tang Hall, because all of the content of the objects is living in that screen there, it has to be as open and available to as many people as possible. We were a little concerned about crowding, but we did enough physical prototypes leading up to, or in the design process, and we realized that crowding of a small group is okay. People were really bouncing ideas off of each other and having conversations, or parents were asking their kids questions prompted by the text, or asking or telling them how to look or how to rotate this object. So that was good. But I just think general integration strategy and tying it to the case, if that's where your content is, has to be as cohesive as possible so people know what they're doing when they walk up to it. They see, in our case, they see an object, they see it in the menu below, and they and hopefully intuitively touch it to get more information. And then just in general, UI design accessibility is a big thing for us. We're just try and make it better every time we do a project. But yeah, I think a lot of that informs the design as well. And then how it all ties together is an important long process.
Yeah, and I think at the MFA Houston, Chelsea, we've been working on, you've been working on now, using evaluation as a way to build some advocacy around where to put things.
Yeah, you know, some of our first kind of forays into these digital kiosks, some of the curators may not have been completely sold on the value that they added to the exhibition, and sometimes things got stuck kind of in the corner or, you know, kind of in these out-of-way spaces, and so doing evaluation just about simple usage, you know, how many people entering the space are aware of these things and are using these things. We're able to show, you know, if you stick it in a corner, people aren't going to use it, and the content that we've developed and spent so much time and effort on isn't being seen. So we have been able to really advocate for kind of more central locations, which has been really exciting. And something else that I'd like to just kind of throw into the mix around accessibility too is language. You know, in terms of providing content in multiple languages, something that didn't appear on the two examples that I showed is that we have moved in the direction of always providing our content in both English and Spanish, because a significant portion of our visitorship speaks Spanish. So that's something that if we have kind of the time in order to kind of properly build out in both languages, we do. But it's something that, you know, we just are kind of aware of. You know, Houston's a very international city, and we are providing things in Spanish, but there are a wide variety of other languages that we are not providing. So there's a balance there to be sought, and I'm not sure where it is.
Yeah. And this is where I think we can really grow as a field, is standardizing some of these aesthetic and accessible choices so that we can use it as an advocacy tool within our institution, that, like, here's a list of organizations that are doing things this way because it's the best way to do them for our visitors. So I'm wondering, does anyone have any kind of best practices as an institution that you always follow? Are there certain rules? In the back? Yeah, standing up.
Since this all exists digitally, what we do is there's no reason you can't invoke text to speech.
That's great. Can you tell me your institution real quick? The Canadian Museum of Human Rights. So all anything digital, you offer a text-to-speak option. That's awesome. Yeah. Great. Peter? Great point. So at SF MoMA, text to speak is just one element because you also it only shows the text that's there, or only shares the text that's there. Anything visual you need to describe as well. Yeah, that's a great point. So visual descriptions as an added layer of this piece. Anyone else have a best? Yeah.
And zoom on everything, so they can pinch and zoom anywhere, even though you can't tell. We don't indicate it, but we have like the guest experience staff will tell guide a user on how to do it, and that's just baked into the app from the get-go.
That's great. And what's your institution?
It's just the Shedd Aquarium in Chicago.
Okay, so the Shedd Aquarium bakes in color blindness, which I never thought of was a really great idea, and pinch and zoom on all of their products. So we're going to jump along. We've got about 3 minutes to dig into this really simple question of how we measure success. basically, what we're really thinking about here is, should we all be using the same metrics? Should we kind of standardize this so that we can establish some benchmarks, again, so we can advocate and really grow this part of our field? Do we need to measure just quantity and quality? And there's so much around this to unpack. I'm trying to think who to jump to first. Taylor, I think you have numbers, observation, feedback, and as a kind of cohesive view.
Yeah, I think this is a good question just for us to think about where we are. I mean, when we do a project, whether it's this hall-wide thing or just an independent kiosk somewhere, every use case has been pretty unique for us, so we'll build out a cohesive evaluation plan, front-end, iterative, and then summative, and then being more and more systematic about programming out our analytics, and we're trying to be better about that as a team, but I'm just wondering and hoping, with this database we're kicking off, that if the more people can contribute, maybe we can start to group together similar types of things, and maybe from that we can start to share what those guidelines could potentially become. I mean, it never would be set in stone, but I'm just starting to like think and talk at the same time. But yeah. I would hope that's where we can go, just so we can really start to cross-collaborate and share. And so like Art Institute and Field Museum have this set of digital labels. What's similar about it? How do you measure those things? You know, and then kind of go from there.
Mm-hmm. And Tina, did you want to jump in?
Yeah. I mean, we're making sense of our analytics right now, but I think that it would just be really beneficial to see the visitors in the space and see what they're doing. Like I was saying before, you know, and what others have said, you know, is this becoming a social experience? Are people talking about the object more? We have the intention that, you know, as they're reading these labels and going through that experience, that they're actually looking back, you know, at that object and learning more about it. So are they spending more time with this object and learning more about it and sharing that experience with others?
Mm-hmm. And I think that's one thing I keep coming back to and talking with other people that are in this room and all you all is that the analytics you get from the digital experience are really, really helpful. But it's not until you physically get in the gallery and observe that you get a full picture of what's happening and the value. And I think that the observation portion is the more difficult thing to evaluate, and I think that's something as a field we can really help each other figure out how to do easily and quickly and share our findings in that. We're right at 11 o'clock, but do you have any burning questions before we leave? Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question. Is anyone thinking about taking their in-gallery content and putting it online just the way it is or tweaking it? I think, Tina, you guys were...
Yeah, I mean, we definitely have that intention, but I don't know. I don't know if it would be in the same form. You know, right now, it's, you know, if I thought about just off the top of my head, the experience we have in the gallery and putting it on the web, like, I wouldn't want to just, like, open a new window and just, like, have that same experience, like, in a new window on the web. So, yeah, we definitely are planning on it, but we need to figure out, yeah, what that experience is going to look like, how it's going to transform for the web.
Because it's such rich content, but the environment is why it was created. So that's can't just be cut and pasted onto the internet.
And if anyone has good examples, please share.
Yeah, does anyone have good examples on that question? Yeah, so you made a great point that putting things online, you have the added issue of rights and the money and issues around that are added to it. Is this question, I want to get different questions if we can. Yeah, go ahead.
It's a follow-up.
Okay, go ahead. Any other questions before you go to coffee?
Did you have a question?
Yeah. Question? No. Well, thank you all for your added discussion to this. I do want to emphasize, if you can please fill out the Google form. I have gotten a couple tweets that it's a little messed up right now. Well, that's my bad. Didn't have enough coffee this morning. So I'm going to fix that. Give me like 10 minutes and then start submitting, and I'll retweet it out and all of that. So thank you so much for being here.